All right. This is kind of a dream when you grow up listening to James Brown, and people were asking, that James Brown? Yes, that James Brown. Of course that James Brown.
You feel good.
Oh, I feel good. And just to be clear, John said I have 17 to 18 minutes, and in my fantasy, at the end of it, I'd be doing a Please, Please Don't Go, where he'd be putting the cape on, and I'd be coming back, and all the rest of that. But that's too self-indulgent for a Midwestern historian. But in my fantasy, you know, I'd be doing that, and you guys would be going crazy, and I'd in agony come back and add one more pithy quote. But I'll save you from all of that. So this is an unlikely moment that was really spanned by we've digitized all of our resources at the University of Indianapolis, including this gem that's a minute and a half long. So this is a centerpiece of a story that I'm still trying to figure out, which is how that James Brown and that Richard Lugar came to be in the same spot. And I tested earlier, sound should be good. Keeping in mind that it's James Brown, and if you can understand more than half of the words that he's saying, you're ahead of the game.
On behalf of all of the citizens of Indianapolis, a key to the city to James Brown. Can I say something? I want to say thanks to you for the key, because if it hadn't been for you, it wouldn't be possible. So I hope this keeps the service of momentum and the service of constructive thinking and equal opportunity to everybody. Now, there's one thing I'd like to say before I leave, and I hope you join me in saying it. I don't want nobody to give me nothing to open the door. I'll get it myself. Come on! I don't want nobody to give me nothing to open up the door.
So you can imagine, but there's a little bit more here. You can't hear what they're saying. I saw a couple of you mouthing. You knew what you were supposed to say in response. I'm black and I'm proud, which you can't really imagine too many other mayors being comfortable at that point in time in an urban area with that many youth gathered. So for me, the project became, what was this? And how can we use this little 1.5 minute clip to try to unpack the ways in which Midwestern Republicanism, black power, and politics intersected in the little bit of time that I have here. And again, this is part of what's become a pretty longish paper because there's a lot to talk about here. You all know James Brown. I would like to think you all know Dick Lugar, Indiana's longest serving senator, who was elected to the Senate in 1976 and served through 2012. But before he became known as an expert on foreign policy and an advocate of safe nuclear disarmament, he was the two-term mayor of Indianapolis upon his surprising election in 1967. So this episode took place in May of 1969. I'm not originally from the Hoosier State, but May at any time is the 500 month. So that kind of overshadows a lot of what we're talking about here as well. So these two unlikely allies, James Brown and Dick Lugar, were looking for new alternatives to the integrationist policies that really had seen their apogee around 1965 as part of Lyndon Johnson's Great Society. And I think, as I said, you can look at Republicanism and black power and see how the agendas briefly overlapped. I think the shared space rejected some of the integrationist assumptions behind liberalism and the Great Society. And we might think of this as a path not taken for Republican politics and for black power. And rather than treating it as a novelty, that we should think about it fairly seriously. So there are two main reasons for the intersection of these unlikely partners. Luger's ambitious program to provide summer opportunities for kids, which was called Project Upswing. So Project Upswing lasted a number of summers in Indianapolis, really trying to do anything they possibly could to make sure that Indianapolis did not have urban unrest the way many other cities, particularly in the Midwest, did. Second, there's a matchmaker who had unlikely connections to both, Richard Milhouse Nixon, who in the nadir of my teaching career, I was once told I looked like by a student, and that was when the hair was just starting to recede, and I knew what he was talking about, and the most painful moment where I was like, man, I can see it. I'm never going to let him forget that, unfortunately. And so if I start sweating and need to shave six times in the next 15 minutes, you'll know why. So I said Luger got elected in 1967. He's most known in Indianapolis for what he did in the city for unifying the city and the county, which for everybody who's around there knows it as Unigov. They worked on that legislation following landslide elections in 68, and that took effect on January 1st, 1970. They did so without a referendum, I would add, too. For James Brown, some background. Obviously, he got into that little bit at the end from the song in 1968, Say Aloud, I'm Black and I'm Proud. Go back a little bit more and try to walk through these connections as briefly as I can. Part of the reason that James Brown occupied the central unifying place was following the MLK assassination. And we've got an author of a great book on Bobby Kennedy in Indiana with us here, Ray Boomhauer, and so there's a lot of scenes here. But Luger was mayor when MLK was shot, and there's a whole story about how there weren't riots there because of Bobby Kennedy's speech. In Boston the next day, there weren't riots because James Brown went on and gave a show. And the show got interrupted as black kids came up on stage, and you can find it on YouTube. It's also in a not great way in the most recent movie where they dramatize the scene as well. But it's a statement of black power again, where he says, we can do this ourselves. And he's credited with keeping the peace, which then launched this unlikely portion of his career where he was a spokesman for black America and had a bridge to Republicans, even though he had supported Hubert Humphrey in the 1968 election. So Humphrey gets elected, Nixon's coming up with inaugural balls, and if you look here, James Brown actually played at the inaugural ball, where he also performed Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud. And that's probably a whole other interesting story that seems also unlikely. But as Luger and the Nixon administration were working as closely as possible on a number of different strategies to bring capital of any sort and resources of any sort to Indianapolis, James Brown became this figure that could be used in order to achieve that agenda, and James Brown had his own moments as well. So I think part of the key to this is actually understanding that song that he broke into a cappella, which if you aren't a James Brown scholar, you probably don't know that I don't want nobody to give me nothing, open up the door, I'll give it myself, which is the full title of the song, peaked at number 20 on the pop charts. And went all the way to number 3 on the R&B list. That came out in March of 1969. Again, this Giving the Key to the City was in May. So it was his most recent hit. And I would argue that it's also the most political of all of his songs, save for Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud. And again, this is in true James Brown fashion, a 6 to 7 minute song that I won't play all of. But you'll get an idea of the message that he was trying to talk about, which I think resonated quite deeply with Richard Luger and with Republican politics, a way in which black power was not as radical as most people imagine it to be, but could be fashioned, in fact, in fairly conservative, traditional ways. So that's a kind of the core of this song. Again, I'm now asking you to do that most unlikely of things, reconstruct James Brown's lyrics, right? And my dad growing up would always say, if you're looking at James Brown's lyrics, you're missing the point of his music. But that song has so much in it about black power and what it meant that I think you could just unpack that the entire time. That last hook there, that was not the hook, but the last bit, he said, we got talents we can use on our side of town. Let's get our heads together and get up from the ground. A little bit later on in the song, he says, I'm not going to tell you what to do. I'm not going to raise no fuss. But before you make another move, let's start by taking care of us, which is also about the black community taking responsibility for themselves. And this was a vision of a pluralist society. It would seem to be one that the likes of Malcolm X, Stokely Carmichael could support. Strong African-American institutions that were grounded in community. And when Brown discusses, as he did in the part that I played for you, our side of town, he recognizes residential segregation that still existed throughout much of the country, including Indianapolis. Rather than despairing, however, he preaches a message of self-help and uplift. And I think it's that message of self-help and uplift, that's so important to understanding how they occupied the same space. And I think those of you who are more familiar with the historiography of the Nixon administration, Dean Kowalski's book, which is probably the single best volume on a lot of that material, would know that the New Federalism and the Philadelphia Plan were Nixon administration initiatives that promised to return more decision-making and more autonomy to local communities. And that's precisely what Dick Lugar was trying to take advantage of, to try to build up a city that had, for years and years and years, rejected any kind of federal money whatsoever because they didn't want bureaucrats from DC to tell them what to do. Okay, and so this is how they came to occupy some of the same space. I think it's beyond the scope of this paper to detail all the initiatives that Lugar was pursuing. But between 1968 and 1970, his administration pursued at least four initiatives designed to aid the African-American community. The first was Project Upswing, that I said this was all a part of. They brought a number of entertainers to town, the Guess Who, among them, Dolly Parton, some others. Again, those are all separate stories. Second, a black capitalism task force that met a lot in 68 and 69. The third was a task force on housing, and the fourth was working with model cities, a federal program called Operation Breakthrough, headed by George Romney. And that one in particular, where they were working with the private sector to provide public housing and really any other federal program that could bring expertise and capital to Indianapolis, as I said. Now, there are a lot of limits to that approach. And our colleague Richard Pierce at Notre Dame has written about those most persuasively. And I would point you to his book called Polite Protest for that. In the instance of interest of time, I won't get into that right here. But I think notably absent in all those reforms I just talked about that Dick Lugar undertook were any kind of development of African-American political renewal, right? Which is a whole separate conversation. And indeed, the class that benefited from Lugar's initiatives the most were individuals who had lived the lyrics contained in James Brown's song. They had already created most of their opportunities by working within the system rather than against it, okay? So if we back away from 1969 and look to the 1970s, I'll just hint at this, and there's much, much more to come. Brown and Lugar continued to have at least one connection, and that was Richard Nixon. Lugar got to give one of the keynotes in 1972 in Miami at the Republican National Convention, and James Brown, prior to the election this time, endorsed Richard Nixon as well, and got a lot of backlash from the black community for doing so. Brown then also went on to redefine his sound, Fire the Famous Flames, which were the backing group heard here, and hire Catfish and Bootsy Collins, which he dubbed the JBs, and reinvent an even blacker, funkier sound than he had in 1969 when he was with Dick Lugar, okay? And I think by 1972, Lugar had become Nixon's favorite mayor, and as I said, Brown had endorsed the president, in part, he said, because it was his patriotic duty as a countryman, his words, regardless of his past political preference. So I'd just like to close by saying that it's easy to dismiss the Brown-Lugar appearance as mere pomp and circumstance, but I think it would be a mistake to do so. I think we can connect art and politics in meaningful ways, and I would also submit that for any of the faults that one could find in the political climate surrounding local government in Indianapolis circa 1969, 1970, both the city-state and the country would be better off if more Republicans ran major cities today so that they couldn't be the purview of just one political party. Since Lugar's time as mayor, it has been far too easy for the Republican Party to turn its back on America's urban areas. This has profound implications for all of us, even for those of us who would rather open up the door and do it ourselves. Thank you.
Elected to Congress 6 times as a progressive and 5 times as a Republican, Merlin Hull was probably the most successful Wisconsin progressive political leader not named La Follette. Or as Glenn Beck says, Waffletti. As a politician who refused campaign contributions, famously cast the deciding vote against his own party's proposal to significantly reduce income taxes, and considered prohibition a failure only because it had never been tried, Hull was not an ordinary Wisconsin representative. While historians generally terminate the Progressive Era sometime around the beginning of World War I, obviously that news never reached Wisconsin, or the regions that Hull called the Northwest. And the Northwest included northwestern Wisconsin, Minnesota, North Dakota, the homeland of the DFL, Wisconsin Progressive Party, and the nonpartisan wing. To his core constituency, Wisconsin dairy farmers, no action in Hull's political career ever topped his 1931 amendment to an army spending bill that stopped the military from serving dairy substitutes on U.S. military bases. This was a culmination of an effort in which Hull had worked with representatives from dairy constituencies to build a unified effort. And of course, this was in 1929. For 10 years, agriculture had been in a very serious recession. Raw milk prices had plummeted. Farm values had dropped. The economic crisis was generally great. Dairy farmers, unlike well-organized tobacco cotton farmers, had never been very effective in unified action, in part because the dairy, the whole dairy system is different. The act, by the way, 2 months later, John Bryant, president of the very powerful and still very powerful Land O'Lakes Dairy Cooperative. By the way, we had Land O'Lakes butter this morning served with our meal. If you're from Wisconsin, you notice that those kinds of things. Brandt told Howell that his action probably had saved the livelihoods of thousands of dairy farmers in the upper Midwest. And while the Depression would go on for another 10 years, and when Hull returned to Congress in 1935 as a member of the newly formed Progressive Party, his office would serve as the lobbying arm for the left-leaning Farmers Union. And Bill Sanderson who was a local Wisconsin Farmers Union leader. And by the way, while Hull was still a Republican congressman later on, Sanderson actually ran for the Democratic senatorial nomination in 1950 while working for a Republican congressman. The Republican Party was never very fond of Merlin Hull. The enthusiasm of Wisconsin progressives and the long and noble battle against noxious dairy substitutes has always proved somewhat irritating and confusing to people who believe that the progressives were urban. In fact, Bob La Follette gave his first anti-Oleum address in 1886. Wisconsin progressives were the backbone of the opposition to legalized, the selling of legalized butter substitutes in the state of Wisconsin. It was only in 1967 that you didn't have to cross the state line to Illinois to buy butter substitutes. And it was only because J. Earl Levitt, who was an old progressive and the chair of the Dairy Committee, but had been voted out of office in the previous election and the dark forces from Milwaukee and achieved victory. For progressives, you know, they could come up with an argument against dairy substitutes. That, you know, they could point out the fact that meat packers had the nasty habit of adding a little bit of butter fat to meat byproducts and selling them as butter, you know, stuff like that. But the reality was they always argued that this was fundamentally an economic issue, that the livelihood of farmers were more important. And for them, the argument was the same way you support minimum, if you support minimum wage laws for workers or a living wage, you would naturally support a living wage for farmers as well. Hall was an Indiana native who had served three terms in the early 20th century in the Wisconsin Assembly and served in 1913 as the Speaker of the Wisconsin Assembly. He was an associate of Wisconsin Governor Francis McGovern. And he always had sort of, although he really liked Phil LaFollette, he always had negative feelings about the old LaFollette, who he thought was dictatorial. And he pointed out that the great LaFollette innovation, the open primary, LaFollette actually completely violated by endorsing candidates for office when it no longer served its purpose. And in fact, in 1925, Hull campaigned for McGovern when McGovern ran for the Senate after Bob LaFollette had died. LaFollette, and you know, in 1916, 1918, Hull was elected Wisconsin Secretary of State. In 1922, he challenged LaFollette's favorite, one of LaFollette's key allies, J.E. Beck, in the 7th Congressional District primary, and the chief issue was prohibition. Beck, of course, like lots of Wisconsin progressives, had favored prohibition when it was popular, but by 1922 he had lost interest in the noble cause. Beck defeated Hull in three very close primaries, but in 1928 Hull was elected to Congress. Hull had strong links to organized labor. He was a member of the Typographical Workers Union, and one of his favorite stories was delivering payments to striking homestead steel workers while he was working at the government printing office in Washington, D.C. During the 1930s, the aging Jacob Coxey would often show up at the Hull office and spend time shooting the breeze with one of his favorite Wisconsin congressmen. For Hull, the backgrounds of progressive reform were bread and butter issues. Historians have always been fixated by the somewhat interesting question of who the progressives were. Progressives have generally been viewed as middle class reformers interested in civilizing unruly railroads and immigrants. Bob LaFollette, in fact, you know, this struggled with Theodore Roosevelt. There was lots of self-serving in this conflict. But the truth was, LaFollette had a really different understanding of what it meant to be a progressive. He was a disciple of Louis Brandeis, small government, or not basically capitalist-oriented, non-support for business, small economic units. And Brandeis was a frequent visitor in the LaFollette home, and their ties were very close. The strengths of Wisconsin progressivism, and there's lots of debates about this, and I actually believe that the best argument was the first argument, and that is the homeland of Wisconsin progressivism is the so-called New North of West Central Northern Wisconsin. Of course, there was always strong support in Madison area. After all, that's where the LaFollette were from. Always strong support to the dairy industry. progressivism grew up with the dairy industry in Wisconsin. One of Bob La Follette's first choices as governor was to name an early political ally, William Dempster Hoard of Hoard's Dairymen, to the University Board of Regents. One of the cleverest things in La Follette's political career was to vote against American entry into World War I. And because it solidified support within the large German communities in Wisconsin that had never been very fond of progressive reform. Progressives generally ran poorer in the older regions of southern Wisconsin, Rock County, Richland County, and the fertile farm regions around the manufacturing belt of the Fox River Valley. Scholars have always pointed out the strong link between Norwegian, Finnish, Scandinavian voting and progressive reform. Such studies often ignore the fact that these are precisely the areas that are poorer and less fertile, lower incomes. In 1970, Roger Wyman pointed out that the stronghold to progressivism in both urban areas and rural areas were in poorer neighborhoods. That there's a definite economic component. And that actually corresponds very well with the 9th Congressional District in northwestern Wisconsin that Hull represented. Now, of course, ethnic and cultural considerations are real. And Hull did benefit when he was shipped out of the old 7th Congressional District, where the largest city was the brewing center of La Crosse, and moved into the new 9th district in 1932. He found it a lot easier to get votes from Finnish and Norwegians than Germans. But the reality is, ethnic voting simply doesn't account for it. There are too many strong areas for progressive reforms that just don't meet the ethnic criteria. Greene County near Madison, which initially was largely Swiss, became an early and strong progressive, early 20th century, and Swiss and Democratic switched over to progressives during the La Follette era. In areas in Clark County, which were heavily German, voted overwhelmingly progressive, even though the ethnic composition is a right. What is clear, and here I really consider Elizabeth Sanders' work really exceptional, is that the periphery regions, less tied to the mature industrial core, are the real heartland of progressivism. The big farmer-friendly farm bureau was never much of a supporter of progressive reform. But the more radical cooperatives, the Society of Equity, the Farmers Union, the Midland Cooperative, tended to strongly support progressive reform. Like populists before him, Hull fought to retain competitive capitalism. In the Wisconsin Assembly, his most passionate issue was introducing legislation dedicated to statewide price equity. In Congress, his first legislative success was introducing a bill to investigate pricing practices of chain stores, and he consistently supported legislation investing all monopolistic practices, including Truman Arnold's investigation in the later New Deal of dairy monopolies. The other side of this, besides a strong rural agricultural focus, is the moral aspects of progressive reform. The ministers of reform, to use Robert Crenden's term, or John Milton Cooper's article that talks about La Follette, the political prophet. Hull was a Methodist, an enthusiastic champion of temperance, who once actually introduced legislation to the Wisconsin Assembly that, by the way, was passed the Assembly unanimously, to make it a crime to swear in the presence of women and children. Governor Davidson thought that might be hard to enforce. But as Hull reported, no member of the legislature voted against it. He served as on the executive committee of the Wisconsin Nonpartisan Dry League, the Citizens Education League, both temperance organizations. With Hull, temperance was, of course, closely linked to women's rights. and he had been an enthusiastic supporter of women's suffrage. He sort of despised, by the way, the anti-Saloon League, which had the audacity to actually support a Catholic candidate for governor in 1920. Hull had much closer relationships with the Women's Christian Temperance Union. And one of my favorite Hull stories is in 1930, after he'd been defeated in the Republican primary for re-election, the Jackson County WCTU chapter initiated a write-in Merlin Hull campaign. And he received 60% of the vote in Jackson County as a write-in candidate for Congress. But for Hull and other progressives, prohibition was only one of the many moral issues confronting the nation. Honesty in government, fair treatment of workers, a living wage, fair publicly supported pensions, just treatment of Native Americans, anti-lynching legislation, aid to those in debt, even rural electrification was a moral issue. And as Richland County, Wisconsin native Russell Nye pointed out years ago, there's always a strong social gospel constituency in the progressive tradition. The third aspect I want to highlight is foreign policy. Merlin Hull was an isolationist of isolationists. And what we forget today, of course, is being an isolationist in 1938, 1940, in an overwhelmingly rural congressional district has something that we don't understand, and that is, who wants to have their farm labor force drafted? It's pretty immoral. And so there's always an economic component to these things. But Hull's, probably my favorite Merlin Hull story is, in August 1940 when he was sitting in Congress, and Hull basically never missed a congressional vote. It was sort of his pride and joy. Anyway, an omnibus military spending bill was introduced on this August day in 1961, August 14th, 1941. The bill included an item to construct a War Department building. Hull noted, of course, they had just built a brand new War Department building in 1935, by the way, should be pointed out, that this $35 million item was in the budget, but violated congressional rules. But the chair was pretty convinced, being a Virginian who wanted to move as much of the government as possible to Virginia, that this could slip through. Hull made a point of order. The Rules Committee was gone for the weekend, and so everybody in the country knew about the plans to construct the Pentagon. By the way, the Pentagon that was constructed doesn't have to have the odd shape it does because it's located in a completely different location. Hull argued that it was too expensive, probably wouldn't be complete until after the war was over, and only had one purpose, and that is to set up a permanent American empire, which was deeply offensive to all Wisconsin progressives. And Hull said it was ridiculous to think that this would actually cost $31 million. And when it was completed in 1943, it cost $83 million, of course. But for Hull, this was really primarily an economic issue. After the war, and Hull considered this a semi-victory, you know, got the building relocated after all. Hull opposed the bipartisan foreign policy that emerged after World War II. He was one of the few progressives who was still in Congress. Nye, well, most of the others have been voted out of office. He continued to advocate increased defense spending, decreased military budgets, although he supported the United Nations relief appropriations. He was one of 15 representatives to vote against membership in the League of United Nations. Likewise, he opposed peacetime conscription, the Greek-Turkish Aid Bill of 1947, and the Marshall Plan, which he considered immoral, because of course, why would you be rebuilding Europe when there's so much, when 30% of the farms in his district didn't have electricity? Wisconsin progressives, Hull represents sort of the populist progressive tradition that was part of the Wisconsin mainstream. In many ways, it's, while Wisconsin Democrats claim to stand in that tradition, I'll let you decide whether they really do. Thank you very much.
Victory for the Republican Party in 1860 rested on its ability to win the conservative northern battleground states lost 4 years earlier, Illinois, Indiana, New Jersey, and Pennsylvania. Indiana remained the most doubtful for Republican presidential nominee Abraham Lincoln. Indiana's political culture was decidedly more conservative than its neighboring free states. Hoosier Republicans devised a clear strategy to win conservative ex-Whigs that voted in 1856 with the American Party. In particular, the politically influential Richard W. Thompson. This strategy began with the nomination of Henry S. Lane, a personal and political comrade of Thompson, as their candidate for governor. As an ex-Henry Clay Whig of Kentucky antecedents with conservative anti-slavery credentials, Lane ensured the state's Republicans could not be subject to charges of radicalism or sectionalism. Lane directly promoted the presidential candidacy of Abraham Lincoln in Chicago, aware of Lincoln and Thompson's service together in Congress. Lane believed that Lincoln's nomination gave his party the broadest appeal and could bring those affiliated with Thompson into the Republican tent. This paper examines how Indiana's unique political conservatism limited both the appeal and the influence of radical republicanism in 1860. It challenges scholarly assertions, most recently by James Oakes, of the Republican Party's designs to cripple or perhaps eradicate slavery upon taking power. It furthermore emphasizes the lasting strength amongst Hoosier Republicans to sustain the compromised tradition of the U.S. Constitution. When framing the election of 1860, Indiana Republicans argued only for returning to the original designs and intents of the founding generation as regarded slavery. The campaign then promised to present a predictable past rather than a vision of a brave new future. 2 years earlier, in 1858, Indiana Republicans took the unprecedented step of renouncing the non-extension principles of their 1856 party platform and instead endorsing the popular sovereignty message of arch-Democrat Stephen A. Douglas. With the open fracture of Indiana Democrats over the potential admission of Kansas under its pro-slavery Lecompton Constitution, Republicans acted pragmatically. They sided with Douglas and his many Hoosier admirers against Jesse Bright, the state's pro-administration, pro-Lecompton, three-term Democratic senator whose political hatred of Republicans was perhaps only matched by his personal animus towards Douglas. The alliance produced mixed results. Significant Republican victories in congressional elections were tempered by losses in state races. Additionally, Republicans failed to elect a member of their party to the U.S. Senate. The party had nominated Henry S. Lane as their aspirant, noting his campaign work, his growing popularity amongst the party's rank and file, and most importantly, his weight amongst the state's large contingent of American Party voters. In the counties where Lane stumped in 1858, Republicans attracted large numbers of conservative ex-Whigs who in 1856 had voted American, Democratic, or simply stayed home. These voters had familial and cultural ties to upland southern communities in Kentucky and Tennessee. In principle, perhaps they supported free soil, but they found the combination of candidates and rhetoric coming from Republicans in 1856 distasteful and dangerous. Lane's calming appeal and influence was immediate, and Republicans hoped that his ascension to the U.S. Senate would serve as a powerful magnet to this vital constituency. With his attempt at the Senate defeated, a crestfallen Lane sought only limited role for the party in 1860. Yet Indianapolis newspaper editor John DeFries, a fellow ex-Clay Whig from Tennessee, had other plans. He viewed Lane as the party's clear favorite to run for governor, and he insisted Lane keep a full schedule and remain in the public eye. Lane did not want to run nor serve as governor of the state. He dreaded the extensive canvass running for the office entailed and saw the work of the executive as little more than drudgery. Lane had set in his heart the U.S. Senate, where his idol Henry Clay had served. And he believed that Oliver P. Morton, a former Democrat who had lost as the Republican candidate in 1856, be given another chance. One of Morton's biggest liabilities, argued DeFries, was his Democratic background, his inability to turn out the largest possible vote amongst Americans in southern Indiana. And as the state nominating convention approached, a steady drumbeat in favor of Lane developed. Admirers from throughout the state trumpeted his sparkling reputation, free of corruption, his service in the Mexican War, his visible participation as a member of the Methodist Church, and his continued ties to, quote, the old Whig chieftains, who were proud of his leadership in days gone by. His conservative anti-slavery politics endeared him to voters concerned about labels of sectionalism and abolitionism. And most importantly, if Lane could win the October election, state election, he thereby set the stage for victory in the November presidential election. Lane finally acquiesced to this pressure, allowing his name to be used. Oliver Morton would be his running mate as lieutenant governor, and an informal bargain was struck whereby Lane, a victorious Lane, would try again for the Senate, and Morton would then step down, then Morton would step in as the chief executive for the state. As winter turned to spring, Republicans were energetic to start the campaign. Republican Congressman Schuyler Colfax requested Lane lead, quote, a general charge along the whole line, all over the state, that would induce our people to feel the canvas open hopefully. His first stop was in Wayne County, located in the heart of the state's abolitionist territory. The event was calculated to heal lingering party mistrust and to prove that Lane's conservative anti-slavery position were sufficient enough. The speech he gave had a decidedly positive effect, with newspaper editor Isaac Julian, the brother of longtime radical abolitionist George W. Julian, describing it as a capital one, the one that would have been called radical a little while ago. He continued, quote, let the old friends and admirers of Henry Clay and the early, more radical friends of the slave enlist under one banner, and let them mutually respect the opinions of one another, end quote. Next, Lane moved to canvass southern Indiana. Following precedent, he agreed to hold joint debates with the Democratic candidate Thomas Hendricks from April 17th through May 5th, and all 16 appointments would be scheduled, tracing the border counties along the Ohio and Wabash rivers. 12 of the engagements took place in counties where the Fillmore vote 4 years earlier exceeded that of Fremont. Strong early showing here would go a long way towards erasing those deficits. Wrote a Republican from the southern Indiana city of Cordon, Republicans of this county are having a meeting, and a visit from you can do more than 1,000 any other men. Teasing out the differences between slavery, white Southerners, and the political powers that advance slavery's interests, it proved a difficult task for Lane. At times when Democrats seemed to have boxed him in or tarred him with accusations of sectionalism, Lane relied on racist appeals to win over the crowds. Still, Lane's simple presence in the southern counties left local leaders feeling buoyed. If the party could select a presidential candidate that reflected the conservative nature of the state campaign, they argued, total victory seemed likely. Missourian Edward Bates enjoyed a brief early period of popularity amongst Hoosiers, but John DeFries, as early as 1858, had identified Abraham Lincoln of Illinois as preferable. Lincoln traveled to Indianapolis in 1859, and DeFries arranged a meeting between Lincoln and Lane. Though no record of what they discussed exists, Lane must have been impressed by Lincoln and his potential appeal in the state. In mid-May, Indiana's Republicans traveled to Chicago, uninstructed and intent on advancing candidates who enhanced the viability of their state ticket. Supporters of William H. Seward, New York Senator, aggressively lobbied the Hoosiers, promising campaign money and patronage posts. Henry S. Lane, however, energetically promoted Lincoln. The night before, he went room to room, asserting if Seward were nominated, he would lose his state's October election with potentially disastrous results for November. Ohio radical Republican Joshua Giddings reported on such a meeting. Lane emphasized the danger of the Constitutional Union Party if Seward or some other perceived radical were selected. And in a letter to his son-in-law, George W. Julian, Giddings recalled Lane arguing, quote, it would be difficult, and he felt improbable to carry Indiana for Seward, but would be much improved with Lincoln. Indeed, Lincoln was selected on account of his location, not from objections to Seward or to Chase, but because being a Western man located in Illinois, he was able to carry that state in Indiana, and he was acceptable to the Pennsylvanians. The following day, the nominating process began. Many of Seward's proponents believed they had secured his nomination. Yet as the proceedings continued, it was clear that his path was not so easy. And Lincoln's name was put forth. Murat Halstead of the Cincinnati Commercial described shouting that was, quote, frantic, shrill, and wild. Hundreds of persons stopped their ears in pain. Halstead reported that Henry S. Lane, quote, leapt upon a table and swinging hat and cane performed like an acrobat. For all three rounds of balloting, Lincoln secured the undivided support of Indiana's delegates under Lane's direction and athletic demonstrations. On the third round, Lincoln won the nomination amid chaotic and thunderous cheering, and energized by the outcome, Lane delivered a fiery parting speech predicting a 10,000 vote majority in Indiana. The real test of Lincoln's nomination would be its effect on the course of Indiana's former Americans, now Constitutional Unionists, who had selected John Bell of Tennessee as their presidential candidate in April. Encouraging signs came from Richard W. Thompson, the party's leader, centered in Terre Haute, who warmed to news of Lincoln's nomination. Thompson and Lincoln had served together in the 30th Congress of the United States, both Henry Clay Whigs, in opposition to President Polk and the war in Mexico. In his memoirs, Thompson reflected that with their time in Congress, quote, there speedily grew up between us such close and intimate relations as only exist amongst those who are sympathetic and in unison. After the nomination, they exchanged letters where Thompson indicated defeat of the Democratic Party, his primary goal, and characterized the Bell movement in Indiana as weak. Lincoln sent John Nicolay to Terre Haute, meeting with Thompson to discuss the possibility of further cooperation. And at the July Indiana State Convention of the Constitutional Union Party, the July State Convention of the Indiana Constitutional Union Party, Thompson parried accusations he had not done enough to organize the party and ultimately begged out of serving as a presidential elector in November. Conflation of Republican candidates with the policy goals of the Constitutional Union Party characterized Thompson's efforts in the final weeks of the campaign. Thompson viewed Lincoln as right on the slavery question because his votes on the issue while in Congress were the same as his own. His honor, however, prevented an open endorsement, always professing to support Bell despite his doubtful electability. Now, Henry S. Lane suggested Thompson speak favorably in both and win the admiration of all those who oppose the democracy. When editor George T. Prentice of the Louisville Journal encouraged Southern Indianans to vote for Stephen A. Douglas, Thompson made his clearest endorsement yet. Just days before the October election, Thompson printed a circular entitled To the Conservative Men of Indiana, criticizing outsiders who felt it necessary to meddle in Indiana's domestic politics. He declared he could not consent to continued Democratic rule, given the corruption and incompetence of the current administration. And while he did not agree with Republicans on every point of the slavery question, he believed their candidates, Lane and Lincoln, would promote, quote, reasoned moderation and guard against the influence of sectionalism and extremism. A disappointed Prentice condemned the circular, equating Thompson with abolitionists and those who would, quote, seek to excite bloodshed by inflammatory appeals to the populations of the slave states. An Indiana Republican victory in October would surely presage one in October, wrote Prentice. Dissolution of the Union would follow. Republican laborers were rewarded on October 9th when voters elected the whole Republican state ticket, Republican majorities to the General Assembly, 7 of 8 11 congressional candidates. Record turnout of eligible voters was abetted by conditions described as clear, cool, bracing, and well-fitted for the day. Once the results were known, Henry S. Lane received joyous and congratulatory letters from all over the state. Observers immediately highlighted the pairing of Lincoln on the ballot as a crucial factor. Quote, "Lincoln as the nominee was the source of our success," wrote a Republican from Knox County. Another from Fort Wayne echoed Lincoln, quote, "Lincoln at the top of our ticket redeemed the state." Old Lion Whigs eagerly offered their adulation, one exclaiming, quote, "No man since Henry Clay had ever in this state such friends as you have." And the earnest backing of the state's Methodist clergy also found recognition in this victory. From one letter, quote, you will remember that there are probably 80,000 Methodists in the state of Indiana, to say nothing of the rest of mankind, whose hearts beat warmly for your success. Republicans secured virtually all the crucial constituencies they needed to win the election. And the correspondents expressed deep gratitude for the sacrifices Lane made in agreeing to lend his name to the contest. Southern Indiana returned an overall Democratic majority, but Lane's candidacy significantly increased Republican turnout. In the governor's race, Republicans won majorities in 10 of 35 targeted counties, including 6 they failed to carry 4 years earlier. In 13 counties, Republicans increased their vote total by 25%. Across the whole 35-county region, Republicans cut their margin of defeat from approximately 12% of all votes cast in 1856 to 6% of all votes cast in 1860. On November 7th, the victory was replicated, with the state's 13 electoral votes going to Lincoln. As in October, the party's most impressive gains came in the targeted 35-county region of southern Indiana. 4 years earlier, Millard Fillmore had out-tallied Fremont in 21 counties and garnered an overall majority against Fremont of 1,500 votes. In 1860, Lincoln defeated Bell by over 38,000 votes. As in the governor's race, the nomination of a former ex-Henry Clay Whig, Lincoln cast the election in the political light more attuned to the second party system. The division amongst Indiana Democrats between Hoosier Joe Lane and Illinois Senator Stephen A. Douglas also depressed Democratic turnout and morale. According to Republican Daniel Bears, Douglas men were particularly susceptible to voting for Lincoln and Republicans in the first and third districts. Wrote Bears, quote, "Douglas will not receive the nomination because the South refuses him, and his Indiana supporters need to know this." In his memoirs, Richard W. Thompson described the nomination of Lincoln as, quote, "a triumph of conservatism. Through the person of Lincoln, Republicans were able to match the public perception of their candidates and support the language of their platform." In Indiana, the nomination of Lincoln gave conservative ex-Whigs, Thompson amongst them, confidence to support the Republican standard. Abolitionists and disunionist radicals were now repudiated. The blessings of freedom secured by the conservative principles of the U.S. Constitution would now be guided by conservative men. In supporting the Republican standard, these voters willingly endorsed propositions in keeping with previous acts, including the North Passage of the Northwest Ordinance, Missouri Compromise, and Compromise of 1850. According to Thompson, these acts boiled down to four general principles. First, that the national government could not constitutionally interfere with slavery in the states, but states held the power to introduce, maintain, or abolish slavery at their own pleasure. Second, the constitutional obligations required the return of fugitive slaves to their owners. Third, that freedom was a natural condition to the territories. Fourth, the Constitution did not carry slavery into the national territories by its own force. I'll go ahead and end. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I'm going to just give you a definition of cultural pluralism. It's one of these things that, and don't look at her yet. the sideways one. Okay, got it. Now, Philip Gleason defines it broadly as the general vision of a society made up of diverse groups all interacting harmoniously without losing their distinctiveness. That's a nice general definition. Today it's become so loose and generic that it's kind of lost a lot of its meaning. But in Jane Addams's day, she came up with something that was quite groundbreaking. So I'm going to begin by talking about looming above all these figures is Jane Addams, who profoundly influenced every aspect of pluralistic thought and practice in the era with her ongoing on-the-ground activism, influential publications, and firm faith in cultural reciprocity and the power of immigrant groups to create a richer, more vibrant national culture. Building upon Addams' insights, philosopher Horace Kalin, and I'll go to Horace Kalin, who coined the term cultural pluralism in 1915 and amplified it as an ideology while teaching at the University of Wisconsin, we forget the fact that he was in Wisconsin and inspired by the Midwest when he came up with this concept. He taught there between 1911 and 1918, and the Midwest inspired Horace Kalin. Leftist intellectual Randolph Bourne developed much of his notion of the transnational America while visiting Kalin in Wisconsin and witnessing the cultural mosaic of the rural Midwest. And then there are two Norwegian Americans I'm going to write about later on, Ole Volvag and Vladimir Auger. I don't think too many of you are interested in them, but they'll come later in my project. So Addams and Kalin made the most earliest and most penetrating contributions to this debate, providing urban and rural visions of cultural pluralism that resonated a century later. Addams, the daughter of an abolitionist politician, friend of Lincoln's, and friend of Lincoln in rural Illinois, and Kalin, the European-born son of an Orthodox rabbi in Boston, came from contrasting backgrounds and developed their pluralistic theories in settings dramatically different from the places of their childhood and youth. As you'll see, Kalin's introduction to the rural spaciousness of Wisconsin and Addams' immersion in the cultural maelstrom of Chicago's near west side indelibly shaped their visions of cultural pluralism. Inspired by settings strikingly different from their childhood landscapes, both pluralists relied, nevertheless, upon recollections of their earlier places. Addams, in particular, drew upon memories of her rural black background in the Lincoln Republic to forge pluralistic thought and practice in the heart of the city. Her pioneering theories of cultural pluralism and the cosmopolitan neighborhood, very intriguing notion, the cosmopolitan neighborhood, evolved during the nearly two decades between the founding of Hull House in 1889 and their full expression in her newer ideals of peace in 1907. But these seminal ideas had even deeper, more subjective roots in her childhood in the emerging Midwest. Okay, I'm going to begin later. In 1913. In February 1913, Jane Addams began a four months of foreign travel to recuperate from a strenuous stretch of writing, publishing, and public advocacy. 53 years old and at the height of her power, the height of her power, Addams had just finished an extraordinary year of accomplishment that helped make her, in the words of one of her biographers, quote, the best known public woman in the world. 1912 had been a whirlwind halcyon year for Addams. In 12 months, she had published two powerful books, 20 Years at Hull House, and An Analysis of Prostitution, A New Conscience and an Ancient Evil. In addition to her continuous organizing committee work and efforts at Hull House, Addams published at least 26 articles in 1 year. She testified before Congress for women's suffrage, promoted the NAACP, spoke out against lynching, seconded Teddy Roosevelt's nomination for president for the Progressive Party in Chicago, campaigned for Roosevelt giving stump speeches through 12 states in 1 year. Addams did this and more at a breakneck pace in the space of a year. She would go on to publish 5 more books and hundreds of articles, spearhead a courageous pacifist campaign during World War I. She was pilloried for this. She was so brave. She was amazing. Won the Nobel Prize in 1931 and would complete many other projects before her death in 1935. When she set sail for Egypt in the Mediterranean in early 1913, she was at the peak of a prolific career and at a retrospective moment in midlife. This trip sparked serious reflection about the course of her life, a sentiment explored in an article she published a year later titled should a woman over 50 feel old? No. But anyway, she was thinking about this stuff. See? So while visiting the Theban Hills in Egypt, I found the Theban Hills, Adams had a sudden insight, an epiphany, unlocking long-hidden childhood memories and uncovering a vision of human continuity across time and space that gave higher purpose to her life's work. This is just an epiphany that she had. Viewing 3,000-year-old hieroglyphics on the wall of a royal tomb, Adams experienced a Proustian moment, releasing a flood of forgotten events from her Cedarville childhood. Quote, "In the presence of these primitive attempts to defeat death in Egypt," she recalled, "I found myself living over the emotions of a six-year-old child, coming face to face with, quote, the terrors of death in Illinois. Experienced a sudden, quote, revival of primitive and overpowering emotions belonging to, quote, a small person with whom I was no longer intimate. Adams recaptured memories of a revival meeting where she and other children, quote, felt the hot breath of hell upon their cheeks. She instantly recalled two funerals for parents and the anguish of their grieving families, and she relived her childhood rebellion against the Christian notions of reward, retribution, and the afterlife." All these things kind of came up when she was there in Egypt. A final recovered memory brought resolution to these haunting images, allowing her to transcend her fear of death to a larger sense of human purpose. Adams would recall other childhood moments in other publications, but her 1913 revelations contain her deepest Midwestern memory, and it deserves to be quoted at length. She had this thing in Egypt. I saw myself as a child of 12 standing rock still on the bank of a flowing river with a little red house surrounded by low-growing willows on its opposite bank. This is Jane Addams. She remembered this. Striving to account for myself for a curious sense of familiarity by conviction that I had no longer known it almost, that I long ago known it almost intimately, although I'd certainly never seen the Mississippi River before. Had a nice shot at the Mississippi River. I remember that, much puzzled and mystified, at last I gravely concluded that was one of those intimations of immortality that Wordsworth had written about. The memory of evening light shining through the blades of young corn in a field passed on the way has remained with me for more than 40 years. This is his childhood memory. Such ghosts of reminiscence, indicating higher truths for Adams, became powerful manifestations of that new humanism, these are words, which is perhaps the most precious possession of this generation. It became the secular creed that sustained her life, and her essay ends with an illustration of this new humanism through a sudden shift of perspective as her memory of being a child beside a broad flowing river is abruptly replaced by the sight of present-day Egyptians toiling, I think I've got it, present-day Egyptians toiling to wrest a living from the parched soil beside the Nile. She's linking these two different places and two different, vastly different times. Instantly recognizing a link between struggling fellaheen in Egypt and a fearful child in Illinois, and between striving immigrants in Chicago and common people everywhere. Remember, this is 1913, when she's thinking back. Adams' time transport provided, in her words, quote, "an almost mystical sense of the life common to all centuries and of the unceasing human endeavor to penetrate into the unseen world," end of quote. Such transcendent moments and visions of solidarity, she concluded, offer, quote, "glimpses into a past so vast that the present generation seems to float upon its surface as thin as a sheet of light which momentarily covers the ocean and moves in response to the black waters beneath it." Very mystical statement. She had this experience. So if Adams' Egyptian epiphany unlocked her deepest memories of the Midwest, revealing a cosmic vision of a unifying oversoul, often other less mystical childhood recollections provided a more practical foundation for her theories of cultural pluralism and the cosmopolitan neighborhood. A number of social scientists have explored the vital relationship between childhood places and cognitive development. They have argued that pre-adolescent memories of place have a lasting impact, establishing a necessary bedrock and compass for the rest of one's life. Echoing Carl Jung's belief that, quote, "the little world of childhood with its familiar surroundings is the model of the greater world. I think I have it up there somewhere. Well, whatever. Edith Cobb and Paul Shepard, and I got to know Paul Shepard personally, he's a big inspiration for me, have described how memories of place experienced between the ages of 6 and 12 are lodged in our consciousness and shape our developing intellect. These are crucial years where you live during those years. During these crucial years, Shepard argues, the terrain of its and its natural things become a model of cognitive structure for the plastic, order-seeking juvenile that lasts a lifetime. Cobb pushes this further, even deeper, tracing how creative thinkers throughout history relied upon memories of childhood places to inspire intellectual breakthroughs and moments of creativity. She goes through so-called geniuses, and almost every one of their ideas come from a memory of a childhood place or actually returning to it. It's very interesting, and not just geniuses, all of us. You know, I don't want to be elitist here. Both authors describe, in Cobb's words, the universal links between mind and nature and how recalling childhood places or actually returning them is the source of our most significant ideas and inspirations, the key to renewing our power to create. So Jane Addams depended upon such foundational memories throughout her life, just as her Midwestern contemporaries, Frederick Jackson Turner, Frank Lloyd Wright, Hamlin Garland, use recollections of Portage, Spring Green, and West Salem, Wisconsin, respectively, in the 1860s and 70s, their childhood there, to shape their mature regional expressions. Adams tapped childhood experiences in nearby Cedarville. It's kind of an interesting cluster, and I could put in more, believe me. I got it. It would have complicated the map. Illinois, during the same period, in Cedarville, Illinois, during the same period, to forge her theories of pluralism. Rural childhood landscapes were embedded in their psyches, all of these people. Yet in various and seemingly paradoxical ways, Chicago precipitated their thought. So they come from rural backgrounds, they go to Chicago, and things happen. While the city's Columbian Exposition helped inspire Turner, Wright, and Garland in 1893, the multi-ethnic tumult of Chicago's 19th War deeply influenced Adams as she co-founded Hull House in 1889. A powerful country-city dynamic stirred each of these and many other Midwestern writers and artists during these years. And Adams, more than any member of this generation, devoted her life to the city while drawing upon indelible memories of growing up in the country. And more than any of her contemporaries, she keenly understood the enduring impact of childhood on her childhood in the emerging Midwest. Although Adams' life revolved around, I think I'm going to go to another one here. Yeah, okay, now we're going to get into her childhood, and I know I'm going to run out of time, John, so I just keep going, and we'll see how this works out. Although Adams' life revolved around the dense multi-ethnic neighborhood of Chicago's 19th Ward, you know, we think of her as the city woman, this earlier memory was deeply important. Does that mean I'm done?
Four more minutes.
Her pluralist vision had its source in the rural Midwest. Her childhood in the 1860s and 70s in Cedarville, a small town of 500 people on the rolling prairie just south of the Wisconsin border, left an indelible mark and became the genius loci of her life. She was keenly aware of its enduring impact. As one of her most perceptive biographers has noted, quote, most social scientists do not take childhood to heart. Jane Addams did, and this accounts for the deep depth, the richness of her thought. Jane's parents, John and Sarah Addams, had migrated to, had migrated to northern Illinois from Pennsylvania in the 1840s. And after setting up a saw and a wheat mill in the wooded valley of Cedar Creek, I think I have a picture of Cedar Creek even. Well, anyway, they're her parents. Her father prospered and became a prominent landowner and Republican politician in the 1850s and 60s, his friend of Lincoln's and so forth. During these decades, Cedarville and the surrounding Stevenson County had a varied population of first and second generation Scottish, Irish, Dutch, Norwegian, Swedish, Alsatian, and German Prussian settlers. And you know, so she saw a cross section, nothing like what she saw in Chicago. Such memories of ethnic diversity, but yeah, so she sees 18 different nationality groups in the neighborhood of Hull House. Adams lived a privileged, and yet I'm determined to get to an allusion to Laura Ingalls Wilder here, John, so here we go.
Adams lived a privileged yet death-haunted childhood that she recalled with unblinking realism. While growing up in a big house on a prairie, she was a spoiled, she was a rich girl, but she was immersed in grief and sadness. She witnessed a gamut of human experience and developed an expansive social conscience. The eighth of nine children born to Sarah Adams and one of only four siblings that survived to adulthood. One of Jane's earliest memories was of her mother's death in childbirth in 1863. Death seemed ubiquitous, living in, quote, a house full of children whose mother is dead, imparted a lasting sense of empathy. And the first two chapters of 20 Years at Hull House are vivid, unvarnished, often unvarnished memories that shaped her life, her later life. In this respect, Adams's memories are closer to the dark vision of Michael Lessie's Wisconsin Death Trip than to the uplifting images of Laura Ingalls Wilder's Little House on the Prairie. Okay, the opening pages of Adams' book are a quilt of traumatic as well as bucolic memories. Jane's earliest recollections are of nights filled with fear of mortality and things of conscience. She made a trip to a nearby town, Freeport, with her dad, and she saw tumbled down houses in a slum, and this may sound a little corny, but she says in her book, someday I will have a house, a big house, amidst a slum. You know, it sounds a little canned, but, you know, okay. So what I'm doing here, and I'm gonna run, one more minute, John? Okay, what I'm doing here is just describing her Midwestern background and how that influenced her thought. And she also talks about the impact of nature, to get back to Paul Shepherd's theme. And then my next part is on the influence of Lincoln. She deeply admired Lincoln and talks eloquently about Lincoln. And I may spend some pages on that. And I think the best way to close here is to just run through my five or six slides I have left and kind of narrate a little bit of it here. Here's the Cedar Creek, where she, near her dad had the sawmills on the prairie. Here's the long grass prairie near Cedarville that had such an impact on Jane Adams. Here's Chicago, you know, and she founded Hull House, and I talk about the inspiration for Hull House in 1889. And here's the neighborhoods that, right in the 19th Ward that she lived in. You know, I mean, she wasn't perfect, but anyway, St. Jane. Here's another shot of Hull House and a sketch from 20 Years at Hull House. And here's Jane in her older years talking to children, and a little too angelic maybe, but you know, what the heck. And finally, here's her funeral, and you can see just thousands of people, and she chose to be buried in Cedarville. Okay, and I find that very fitting. And what I say in the rest of this paper is that it's a densely urban vision, but her childhood in rural Midwest really was the basis for it. And the fact that she chose to be buried here. Now my wife says, how do you know she really chose? Maybe I gotta figure that out somehow. But so that's the end of my talk.
Okay, if our speakers would like to move up here, we still have 9 or 10 minutes. I guess Russ, like, yes. Professor Lau.
I'd like to ask a question to Michael and Johnny Miller, and kind of put your ideas in dialogue with one another. This stuff about the psychological impact of ages 6 to 12, yeah, and the importance of that made me think of John Miller's book about all these people that grew up in the Midwest, his book that just came out, Small Town Dreams. And have you comment on what you think the role is, and how does Jane Adams fit into this whole story, and what?
I just love to find somebody else. We seem to be thinking along parallel paths. I don't know if we. I don't usually.
We're separated in childbirth, I think.
No. It's just inductive, you know. It just seems like time after time, somewhere around age. Maybe it's because I discovered baseball when I was 10. Baseball cards, but you know, it's like 10 to 12, give or take. Our personality is, I don't have any profound way to prove that, except that it just seems, yeah, to resonate with me from inductive, you know, reading.
Yeah,
I mean, there are other people, like, well, I guess I mentioned Hamlin, Garland, Zona, mm-hmm. Gale, Turner, I don't know, many others, that little different creative part of George O'Keefe. George O'Keefe group was born there in 1870, I think. I don't know, it's just fascinating, but that means it's ready your question. My childhood in the Midwest, so, yeah. And it was just emerging as a people were beginning, this is another thing, when did they first label it the Middle West? And about 1880s, and so they didn't weren't conscious of the name Middle West, but it was, as they were growing up, this label was emerging. I find that intriguing.
It's kind of an elitist thing, too. We're talking about people who went on to achieve greatness. We're not talking about the common, ordinary run of people who, I think, don't necessarily get this impulse or creative drive or notion that they can do something different from everybody else. I'm not here to answer. Yes, there's
a question. Kind of dovetailing off that. Several years ago when I worked as a journalist in Sycamore, Illinois, I did a piece on Letitia Westgate, who kind of ran a parallel path to Jane Addams, but was really relatively unknown. She tried to be a progressive reformer in the city of Aurora, clean up the drinking water, clean up the milk supply, things that Jane Addams was doing, but she grew up rural Northern Illinois as well. Letitia Westgate, I can give you the spelling later, but I think she grew up around the Princeton, Illinois area. But she was, I often wondered the connection between female progressive reformers like that and the Midwestern background, how many of them grew up in rural areas such as Northern Illinois, Southern Wisconsin, and then tried to move into the more urban areas and clean up kind of the problems that they had there as well. So the gender and then kind of gender component there is interesting, I think, too. The women of Hull House, Alice Hamilton, I think, she went to the University
Ellen
of
Michigan. Ellen Stargates, I don't know.
Ellen Stargates, I'm not sure. She went to Rockford. Alice Hamilton was a Hull House, was attracted to Hull House, but she was a medical doctor. I think she was Midwest as well.
Julia Lothrop.
The
people who visited Hull House were amazing. It's just unbelievable. W.B. Du Bois. I there is some black influence. Mm-hmm.
Maybe we could ask the other panelists, Merlin Hall and James Brown and Luther and so forth, if they have a notion of when they might have got this inspiration, that they could become something special, and how their childhood affected.
Well, at first, Hull research. I got a letter from a woman who knew him, who told me that when he was working on her parents' farm, I told him he was going to be president. But he always felt that Bob LaFalle was in the way.
James Brown, of course, not a Midwesterner, but Dick Luger, born in Indianapolis and raised in Indianapolis, and I think there's always been a kind of rural-urban divide with Dick Luger. Family farm is always talked about as being central to what he's done and a lot of ag policy, but he was an urban kid. He went to Shortridge High School, which was Kurt Vonnegut's high school. So I think there's a really interesting notion there of what it means to be a Midwesterner again, and how a guy who really built his career on being a mayor of an urban space then spent 20 to 30 years kind of broadening things, and in some ways a lot of people outside of Indiana might not think of him as having real urban roots, partially because most people don't think of Indianapolis as being a quote-unquote real city.
Here's a question.
Yes, I had a question for William Costleby. I know one of the big differences between Wisconsin progressives and other Western progressives is on their views on race. That Wisconsin progressives are usually a lot better than other Westerners. Do you know how did Howell fall in?
Well, he of course, his father was a Civil War veteran. And so that is a big difference. I think it's hard, It's hard to say that they had really outstanding views on race. I think certainly Bell Case La Follette was very committed to equality. And and she would have a better record than her husband. But when you live in the essentially, one of the things that's interesting, they also were shaped by the Filipino War, and they were very opposed universally to American, to the Filipino experience. And there's always this sense, and another Wisconsin congressman I've worked on, James Freer, was very involved in Indian rights. And there's always this suspicion that maybe we don't have all the answers for everybody, that maybe other people might have some opinions of their own. It's like Charles A. Beard talked about the American missionary impulse to straighten out everybody.
Here's a question.
Yeah, if I could connect this to a panel earlier today, we're talking about the influence of childhood, the issue of nostalgia that we were talking about earlier. Of course, nostalgia involves constructed memory as well as actual memory. And so some of what we're talking about here is both what actually happened as a child and the way one remembers it as a child, and then you get into the whole notion of nostalgia as both retrograde in some instances but also positive in others that you were bringing out. And so trying to pull all this into some sort of cause and effect with Jane Addams as you were doing, there's some problematizing to do there in terms of, okay, so how do we reconcile the notion of this nostalgia for the past and this nostalgia for stable upbringings and this nostalgia for the way things used to be with, and here's just one statistic to illustrate. So yes, today many people come from broken homes, okay? That's because of a variety of factors, including divorce. Well, 120 years ago, people came from broken homes, but that's because one of the parents died because people didn't live as long. And so, we've got this constructed memory of stable homes and all the rest. And this is sort of a, take it where you will, but a comment on the complexity of linking nostalgia and constructed memory and our whole notion of the Midwestern place is influential upon us, because I was at a gathering the other day with my son-in-law's to-be family outside of Kokomo in rural Indiana, and was sitting there, my wife was remarking how it reminded her of the place, her grandparents' place when she grew up and all the rest. And we haven't had a chance to finish the conversation yet, but now I'm inspired to ask her why. What was it about that place in Indiana that reminded her of that place in rural Ohio 50 years apart? But those are the kind, those mental sorts of creations occur all the time, and trying to analyze them is a challenge.
Yeah. Her memories were traumatic too. They were dark.
Gothic,
childhood death, fear of hell. I don't know if you call that nostalgia.
No, I understand, but some of these aren't nostalgia.
Well, we could go on for a long time, but we got 13 minutes till the next session.
Oh, and
blame John Lauk if you want to blame somebody. We're just running on a schedule here.
How about one more for the road?
Well, if they want to stay, if you want to stay, stay.
As long as we're assembled. I got a question for Ed. And this came up earlier, this question of race reminded me of it. But it looked, to me, it seems like the historiography of race in the Midwest is extremely heavily focused on Chicago and Detroit. But you have all these second-tier Midwestern cities, like Indianapolis, where race relations were seemingly better than Chicago. We'll take that as Exhibit A. And another scholar here was telling me about his research on Des Moines and Omaha being so much better relative to Chicago again. I mean, not great, but relative to these other places, much better. Do you think this is like the opening for an exploration of these second-tier Midwestern cities where race might have been experienced a lot differently than other places?
I could take 4 hours to answer that. I could just say yes and leave one for the road. But I do think there's a lot to be said. And for me, you know, I had a master's student try to do an interesting thing before we had access to Luger's mayoral papers, when he was just looking at secondary sources, trying to compare the mayor of Gary, Richard Hatcher, who was the first black mayor, technically took office right before Carl Stokes in Cleveland. And Dick Luger and Richard Hatcher occupy the same space at almost the exact same time. I think they need each other to define themselves. So Gary defines itself as not being Indianapolis. And if you hear Dick Luger talk reflexively, he talks about these more urban, more industrial, mostly lake cities, and contrasts Indianapolis with them. So he'll just go into the 1960s as a memory, and it's Cleveland, it's Detroit, it's Gary. And he doesn't talk about race, but he's talking about race. And I think that there's a really interesting interconnection that there's a ton of work to be done in that space, and I look forward to reading it from whomever's going to do that. So thanks for the question.
Thanks very much.